this session comes under the concept of design. So it is going to be a little bit deep technical talk. So the goal of this talk is to say how we architecturally evolved Essbase to run on the cloud. Hello? Hello? Okay, so the goal of this talk is to talk about how we evolved Essbase to run on the cloud. As you know, Essbase is more than 24 years old, and it was designed in a day where the technology was completely different. It was also optimized for a different set of metrics. We had mostly 16-bit computer, very little memory, and the goal was very, very different. But the goal then and now is still the same. We want to provide the best analytic experience for users on Excel, right? So today we have modern computers which supports terabytes of memory, a lot of cores, and we need to be secure, scalable, usable, and conform to all the modern protocol standards, okay? So I'm going to talk about different design principles we keep in mind as we try to address all of these issues. The safe harbor usual statement. So there are a number of design principles here, right? What I'm going to cover is, I'm going to touch upon each one of them and see how we, this is what we do every day when we come to work, whether it's me and my team. We need to take care of all of these issues for Essbase to run efficiently on the cloud, okay? First, let's cover architecture. As you know, EPM cloud has been out for a while, more than 3 years. Fusion cloud has been out for a while, more than 5 years, and they both use Essbase. But Essbase standalone, as part of OAC, went live only 3 months back. The reason is, we didn't want to just take the on-premise Essbase server and move it to the cloud. And we realized for us to run for another 25 or more years, we need to have a proper architecture to run on the cloud. Like I said, one of the design principles is it needs to be highly secure, highly scalable, very usable, and we want to innovate very, very fast. For that reason, we said, look, we need to protect the Essbase server by a modern J2E engine. So the donut you see around Essbase server is a J2E mid-tier. Previously, we had just the APS running as a web tier. Now we have a lot more components running in the mid-tier. So we call it a platform. And in addition to APS, we also have a platform. See, this allowed us to build a lot of new capabilities very, very quickly. We have asynchronous job queue, we have cube designer, we have all these unstructured support, and we have a web-based outline editor, and a lot of the management capabilities, load rule editor, all those features that you have been seeing in different demos have all been implemented very, very quickly and using the modern J2E stack. And we are convinced we needed to do this and not use the EAS and Studio because they were not designed for cloud. They don't use the HTTP protocol. If you don't have HTTP to support secure HTTPS, it's very, very difficult. So now with what we have done, all the clients can securely communicate using industry standards, okay? So you cannot penetrate this donut to get to the Essbase server easily. So anything that goes through uses modern communication protocol, whether it's a REST API or HTTPS-based APIs, okay? Along the way, so a fully provisioned Essbase looks like this on the cloud, okay? Let me go through it a little slowly. there is a cloud network which uses a bunch of services in addition to OAC. So what I'm showing in the middle is Essbase part of the OAC, okay? And that talks to DBaaS, which is where the relational schema for the mid-tier is stored. We now store security not in a sec file, but in a table. And that gets stored in that. And similarly, all the job queue information, many of the platform concepts are supported through this DBaaS relational table. And you also have to get a cloud storage that is used for regular backup, okay? And the block storage is where still the Essbase server stores the page and index file in a file system. For that reason, you need to have the block storage. And we see if you go inside the node, we have a J2E web server which runs Java agent, APS, and also the platform. And they talk to all the Essbase server processes, which is still CC++ based, and you are all probably familiar with ESS SVR. That process is still in place, okay? And it can manage like in on-premise any number of cubes. And when you get provisioned in the cloud, unlike SaaS, you get a SSH access to the machine. So that's what that SSH shows. And you can go and run Maxwell or whatever you want within that machine, but we encourage you not to do that. But if you look at the cloud portal, is the way you log into the portal and buy your subscription and all of that through that portal, okay? And all our clients have been changed to conform to the modern standard. It's a web UI which talks just HTTP, and it is the entire cloud is protected by a web server. And SmartView, as usual, talks HTTP, and REST API, and we also have a REST-based command line tool, okay? DB Desktop today talks to the Essbase through the TCP IP port. Many of you are familiar with 1423, and we are going to change that. Today, it doesn't talk HTTP, okay? I will take the question, yeah. So the way it works is the REST client uploads the Maxwell to the cloud and then runs it. So we have invented a new concept called pluggable engine. There is a engine that runs within the J2E that runs your Maxwell on behalf of you, collects the input. So to run Maxwell, it is three step: upload Maxwell, run Maxwell, download the Maxwell output. Okay, so that's pretty much what I want to touch upon the architecture. The concept I want to give you is we didn't want to just simply move to cloud. Okay, we want to be an architecture that sustains for the next several 25 years. That's a theme I'm going to talk about it again and again. Okay. Yes. So this block storage is not our block storage. It is a block storage that you subscribe to on the Oracle network. Okay. So there are different types of storage you can buy in Oracle, and we recommend you to buy block storage, which is latency optimized. So the question was, does any of these remove the requirement of hard backup? The hard backup, the one of the issue is if Essbase keeps writing to the storage, it still writes to the file system. So that issue is still there, okay? If you are copying the file, you might be copying the file in the middle of a write. So that is not removed yet. Okay, I want to say yet, but we have some plans for the future. I'm not yet ready to talk about it, but we will have a scale out and database-based storage, all that we are planning in the roadmap, okay?
Do you still have access to the file system?
Yes, you have a SSH access and you are a root user, you can do whatever you want. But we recommend you not to do it because you may screw up the next patching, right?
So you are not exposing any Essbase client outside of
that? No, yeah. Any client, see, we want you to, we want to take the administration headache from you, right? We would like you to use the industry standard REST-based or HTTP-based so that it is secure, right? But at the same time, I know it's not acceptable. Some people, they would like to have access to the machine, and we do provide you that.
No, but for instance, have my Essbase client running on-prem.
Yeah. It is allowed, right? You just have to rewrite it. You have a max. So if you have written a script, you need to rewrite the script to use our REST command, and then all your investment in Maxel would continue to be there.
What about the client customer that uses
Essbase Studio to deploy? Studio is no longer there. So you need to, for drill through, we have a new support, you need to do that. Yeah, so you have to redesign that part. We have a SQL based, there are different ways of doing it. You can define a load rule in the cloud, and that can read the relational database directly, and then do a dimension and data load into the cloud. Or we also have a remote data push, where when you are talking from cloud to your database, you got to expose some of the relational ports, which you may not want to do it. Instead of that, we have come up with a remote data push that uses HTTP protocol, that it's completely safe, it's within your firewall, it runs a Java program, reads your data, and pumps the data to the cloud using HTTP and HTTPS. No, but if you are doing a dim build or a data load, it will be stored in our Essbase. Yeah. So there are a lot of topics to cover. I mean, what I'm going to do is I will encourage questions, but I'll have to stop when the time runs out. Like, I'm okay with it, okay? Okay, so the next design principle is we love our customers, right? I mean, I think we are very, very committed to them. They are committed to Essbase. There are a lot of them I see who have been using Essbase for more than 20 years. So moving to cloud doesn't mean we forget about them. So one of my key design principles that we also is very much part of our regression is to make sure the previous versions of Essbase will run smoothly on cloud. Okay, we have done a lot of investment in this area to make it easy to move to cloud, okay? That's a key design principle. No matter all the cool things we talk about, moving from 11x to cloud is a fundamental principle that we keep on a day-to-day basis, okay? So there are a lot of details in there, but the key takeaway for you is, if you have a cube running in on-premise, it will run on cloud. There are with a few exceptions, like I said, EAS and Studio are no longer there. You need to get used to certain experience, but functionally, like your partition, your XREF, your load rules, your cal script, your filters, all of them will easily move to the cloud. Okay, I don't want to spend too much time here. If you have any of you have any concern, talk to me offline. So I just talked about our existing customers. So for us, one of the things we thought about like 2-3 years back is when we embarked on this, look, we need to reach out to the new customers. We want to make it easier for them. If you look at cloud, right, it makes it easy to provision a machine. It does patching for you, backup for you, all that. So administration is taken care of. You can, like in Amazon, in Oracle, you can get up and running very quickly on a Essbase. You will get an email saying, like, go to this URL, you can access Essbase. So now what, right? If you are a new user who has been using Excel and pivot table for your analysis, the success for me is an Excel user using pivot table should find it very easy to come to the cloud, right? And that's been one of our key design principles for the last few years. How do we make it easier, right? I know Excel people love Essbase for a long time, but there are a lot of users still are not using Essbase, and they have been using Excel is an awesome tool, right? Nothing to take it away. But they would benefit from putting it on Essbase for all the collaboration and what if and all the other use cases that we know about and Essbase is good at. From that perspective, we started asking, if there is an Excel, can I hide the, we were able to give them a cloud machine so quickly, but can we make a new user who doesn't understand all the vocabulary like dimensions, hierarchy, shared members, can we create that cube automatically for them, right? That was a challenge, and we have pretty smart guys in my team. One guy came up with an algorithm where we do an analysis and transformation. So we start with an Excel, we do some deep analysis, and then figure out, based on the column cardinality and the column relationship, all the business hierarchies. So imagine if you have 200 columns, a million row Excel spreadsheet, or even in a pretty big table, you have to do a lot of manual effort to go figure out, hey, which one of these columns are generation 2 of product, which one of these columns is generation 3, and it's a lot of manual labor. This is where machine is good at, and he has now a new patented algorithm, a guy in my team, which is able to do that for you. So we started with, this algorithm started with inferring the hierarchies to first. So then we got excited. We were trying to fool the algorithm to see where it will break. And we saw some inefficiency. So to take care of that, we started introducing column hints. So that wherever it was not doing the right job, we said, well, look, use make this a generation 2 of this dimension and so on. Then we inferred attributes, which was a big progress. Now we support formulas, where you have a bunch of columns, and if you just simply upload it, you may get a 7-dimensional, each one of them maybe 3 or 4 generations, and it'll be a hybrid BSO cube, which can do an aggregation for you in no time, right? But adding formula was a pretty big deal, right? Now, you can now compute, which is, see if I, let's say if you just did that pure reporting, we are kind of abusing the power of Essbase. The Essbase is pretty good at calculation over aggregation, aggregation over calculation, and you can repeat that, right? So we are able to now introduce new columns. You can just leave it blank, and I can show you an example if you come to the, I think Cameron and Tim have a deep dive session. We are going to show some of these. But you can have like an Excel formula. You can say K1 plus C1. K1 could be another column which we inferred. And all of them would be converted into an Essbase formula and Essbase measures. And you can have up and running with a very sophisticated cube in a no time, just starting with a flat table, okay? So this session is about design and where we are going. So you can see like we have many other transformations in our mind to come up with a more and more sophisticated cube. So what this does is, this Excel to cube eliminates a lot of manual laborious work. So it creates the outline for you, it creates a load rule for you, dimension load rule, data load rule, it loads the dimension, it loads the data, and then all you have to do is press the button, create a cube, jump to smart view, and start navigating the business hierarchy, right? How good is it, right? That's a question a lot of people ask. When we started early last year, it was about 30%. I would say today we are pretty, when you compare to an handcrafted cube, we are about 60% there. Because we still have trouble with shared members, and you still need a human expert and a really good Essbase knowledgeable person to go to the last mile, right? We'll continue to improve over a period of time, but even the experts are better off starting with this approach so that they don't have to do all the manual work, okay? I want to stress the theme again, right? I heard people talk about who have been using Essbase 25 years back. They can run it under their desktop. It was so joyful. And I think we want to go back to that. And I mean, I strongly encourage you to experience that. It's pretty joyful for us. Like, I mean, I'll just give you some inside information. So when I find a bug, for me to report to my QA or QA to report to me, it was a big process. Like, you need to copy this directory, outline file, this and that. Now all I have to do is ship that Excel, right? The process of finding bugs, fixing bugs, that has become so much easier. We consume it a lot. And it's also much easier when we do a sales POC for them to. So my team is, if somebody walks in at 9 o'clock to a customer, by noon they should be able to demo their own cube in our cloud, right? It's much easier. So all the manual steps are eliminated. Just give me your Excel, and we'll be able to build the queue for you. So the next principle is design cubes in Excel. So I just talked about how you can go from a flat Excel to a cube. Now we have another approach where you can actually express Essbase in Excel. Right? It's kind of the reverse of that. You may ask, it's basically like a contract. There is a very specific syntax that we honor, and we read that, and we create a cube for you. You may ask, why do you want to do that, right? Why don't you just build from a cube from Excel and then go to the web UI and edit it? It is a subtle explanation. Let me try to see whether I can do it. Okay, so the thought process is as follows: the flat Excel represents a denormalized table where you don't have any business relationship expressed, and we infer that for you. Almost always, that's not good enough. You want to go to the next mile. If you want to do that, you can go to the only way to do that is to go to web UI and edit it. But we have a lot, very strong Excel community who want to live in Excel. So what we want to do is we want to expand your analysis experience in Excel using SmartView to do the design also in Excel. So the best practice I would recommend, start with an Excel, transform to a cube, that converts a denormalized cube into a fully multidimensional cube, then export it into a DBX workbook, which makes it denormalized into a normalized representation. It breaks down by dimension by dimension. Now it did all the work for you automatically. Now any tweak you want to do, you can do it in Excel. Go and adjust your formula, add a new hierarchy, or add generation, add text measures, change solve order. So there are a number of things you can do to achieve that. So you may not appreciate this. I understand that there may be a lot of doubts about this. But again, back to my experience about being able to share this in a very easy form between the developers, between developer and QA, between sales and developers, it has revolutionized the way we operate, okay? And so basically this gives you Essbase in a workbook, okay? And you can also attach some query worksheets. So you upload it, create the cube, and go to your query worksheet, start doing your analysis. So everything is there in one form, okay? Mike and I are a big fan. Mike is the idea man behind this concept, and he led the team to make this happen. So the question is, how do you handcraft this workbook? We made it easy for you, right? So let's say today you have hundreds of cubes, right? And you do an LCM, go to the cube. You don't have to go from flat Excel to cube. You can even do your, and then you download that as a DBX workbook. You may be surprised. This cube you might have created 15 years back. Now when you look at this as an Excel document broken down by dimension, you may learn a lot about your own cube because you're seeing everything together in a visual form. Right? We experience that. A lot of guys come back and do, I didn't know this was a shared member and this attribute was enabled, and like its purpose as a documentation cannot be understated, right? And not only that, many of us, when you write a new document, you don't start from scratch. You always start from something and you copy it and you just edit it. So you can start with any DBX workbook which represents a cube and make some changes to create a new workbook. And let's say you have an IT administrator, you probably had huge pent-up demand. Hey, look, I have a big fat cube, but can I do my own analysis in my own set of products, in my own geography? I'm sure many of you have encountered that requirement. And it might be a long waiting time for you to provision such a thing, because you may not have enough expertise in Essbase to create such a cube. Now all you have to do is take a DBX workbook, chop off the areas in the dimensional hierarchies that you don't want, and you can just distribute it. You can even upload it to a gallery and you can share within your own team. So one of the customers is thinking about doing that, right? So you can have different types of workbook. You can have your finance team's workbook. And if there is one guy who wants to do deep analysis, you can give his own workbook in no time, okay? Let me summarize this. Our guiding principle is, I think we all love Excel. We are not taking away Excel from anyone. Excel provides you all the easy to use. It provides you an isolation. It provides you full dependency analysis, whatnot. With all the hybrid and all the innovations we did, we are as good as Excel in terms of all the capabilities that it can do. In addition, unlike Excel, we provide you a scalable multidimensional model which allows you to model in a central way, and that allows you to collaborate between multiple users. So this is our guiding principle that we all live by, okay? And I talked about all the new experience as you come to the cloud, but we never forget the fact that people are not buying Essbase for all the cool and greatest tools, right? They are buying Essbase for the engine. And there is a significant competition in the industry, and I'm happy to say we are still the best mobile app engine in the world, and we take that very seriously, right? There are so many innovations that have happened in the last several years. We filed about 15 patents last year on different algorithms in the backend. This year, there are 6 patents being written right now, all in the calculation engine, query engine, BSO and ASO kernel, and the different infrastructure that we are doing. So we maintain our innovative edge, and that's another principle we, as a team, we try to maintain that edge. So let me just touch upon the popular hybrid, right? We have been talking about this for a few years now, and in the cloud, I would say it is pretty complete. So there is always a confusion between hybrid and dynamic. Let me try to explain in a way that you may understand. Hybrid is a query processor, okay? It's a query processor that is used by both ASO and BSO. If we go back in history, what happened was when we did ASO, it had its own query processor. BSO had its own query processor. When you say query processor, what means is when you send a smart view grid to the backend, the way it analyzes that grid was different algorithm in ASO and BSO. With hybrid, it's the same, whether you use BSO or ASO, okay? That is the first thing. But let's say, when does it kick in? If you have a cube on-premise, it's completely stored cube, and you move it to the cloud, and you say you turn on hybrid, nothing is going to happen. So hybrid doesn't work if you don't have dynamic members, okay? It's not good enough just to make turn on hybrid. You got to convert your members to dynamic, okay? Dynamic formulas, dynamic aggregations, they all go through the hybrid query processor. If you don't make it dynamic, it'll go to our old query processor, I shouldn't say old, our traditional query processor is still there, okay? So it'll go through that flow. Are you guys with me? So in Essbase Cloud, we want to consume our own dog food, so to speak, right? So hybrid is the default. So we make a statement with that. We say, look, we feel it is good enough, performant enough, functional enough that we want to put that as a default. So anytime you come in here, if you have a dynamic member, it will go through the hybrid flow. And it's pretty good, okay? We also introduced the notion of application config versus Essbase config. So if you don't like something, if you don't want hybrid, you can always go to an application settings page and you can turn off the hybrid. Unlike SaaS, in PaaS, in our cloud service, you can change your config. Okay, we are after all giving you SSH access to the machine. So what's up? Why should we prevent you from changing your config? All of them are addressed. So if you use cross-dimensional operator, if you use attribute dimension, all of them use hybrid now. Okay. The complete parity between the only thing is that there are a lot of functions. There are some functions which we are like working through each one of them. Some of them that use CUR member are still have some limitation, but it is a very, very, very small set. Okay. So just to recap, what is the benefit of hybrid? You know, I think Mike has a lot of data points. There are some of the queries it used to run for 3 days, it runs in 3 seconds. Like it's weird. Some we were like amazed at what it can do. Many of you might have experienced way back when ISO was introduced, right? Because it has got a similar performance profile. And the beauty of ASO is when you do that unstructured Excel to cube, we make all the upper levels dynamic, right? So the storage shrinks. So as you know, in a multidimensional lattice or a cube, 99.9999% of the data, stored data, comes from the derived values. The source of truth, the loaded numbers, and the lock and send data is very, very tiny. Everything comes from doing a cross product and computing the derived value. When you make all of them dynamic, they all just disappear. So we have seen data points where 50 gigabyte of database becomes 200 MB. It's so tiny and you can keep it in memory. And another important thing to remember is when MOLAP was introduced 20, 30 years back, the notion was, hey, you take the entire weekend to build your cube and open it for analysis during the week. But the requirements are very different now. The data is refreshed constantly, it's real time. Nobody wants to wait for several hours, right? So the key is not to do over-computation and pre-computation. Pre-computation is like computing everything upfront, hoping the user will see it. Why do it? Like most of the time you compute all these billions of numbers, nobody would even look at it, right? And most of the time it's very difficult to fix on a slice accurately that you want to compute. Almost always you over-specify and you do a over-computation. That's where the beauty of hybrid and dynamic comes in. So it is real-time, right? Because I'm not computing any of the aggregates upfront and it's on demand when the user actually wants it, right? So you have addressed a lot of those issues, real-time, on-demand, no pre-computation, no over-computation, and we just compute what you exactly want. And not only that, this is kind of a subtle point a lot of you may not understand. Many of you may have, we have fixed a lot of the corruption issues over a period of time. I'm happy to say EPM Cloud is running on 3+ years, touch wood, with no corruption, okay? But almost always corruption happens when you're storing data to a disk. A lot of time that's where things break down. And if you're not storing any of your data to the disk, the chance of corruption has exponentially reduced. Because you're always computing in memory. As you all know, memory is volatile. Even if something crashes, you bring it up, you recompute it again in memory. So from a stability perspective, it's a lot better. And let's say you want to do a DR. You have one data center and another center. You want to transmit data from one to another. What would you transmit? The source of truth. If the source of truth has shrunken exponentially, your DR strategy is a lot more optimized now. So we are like, on a day-to-day basis, we are seeing so many benefits of hybrid and dynamic. It's like unbelievable, okay? I couldn't fully hear what you said. So you are basically saying you're reiterating my point. So what he was saying is he has a primary hierarchy and an alternate hierarchy which uses dynamic reporting, and he's experiencing a very high response, a very good response time. Okay. No, so you are talking about, do we have bugs in the code? Yes, we do, right? I mean, I'm not saying like any professional software, we use a lot of tools like Valgrind, Purify. We constantly make sure, and we have tons of regressions. We constantly, our engineering hygiene is pretty good, okay? I would like to say our frameworks are pretty solid. Okay. So there are a bunch of other improvements which we have done as part of Excelytics, and that's available in the cloud. We have an in-place data write, and that has reduced the. There is a notion among Essbase administrators, Essbase gets fragmented every few days. You need to go run a defrag. And we got rid of that. So it required a lot of changes in design. And one of the principle was, why did we do that? We wanted to be cloud friendly. There's not going to be an administrator sitting there shutting down the entire cloud till the fragmentation process runs, right? So we wanted to come up with a strategy where we don't have that need. So that's one of the reasons we invented this in-place write, and we did that in Excelytics first. It is now available in the cloud. And I'm happy to report EPM Cloud for the first 6 months didn't have this optimization. So they had a very long AMW window, and since they introduced, they have been running for 2.5 years with none of the cubes requiring a dense defragmentation, okay? That's right. So that buffer is mostly around, we are trying to be a little cute, right? And trying to be a little smart about, look, you entered a forecast in January. Very soon you are going to enter a forecast in February. So why not like reserve the space for you, right? Because anytime a block grows, it is like what OS does, right? Instead of best fit, you go for worst fit and all of those algorithms. It's similar in theme, okay? And we have benefited a lot from that, because if somebody is doing, I do January 1st, in the next round trip die February, every time the block keeps growing, it's pretty frustrating, right? And you are unnecessarily fragmenting it. So that's one of the reasons why we reserve certain buffer. So The question was, any of the VMs, are they on x86? The answer is no. Most of the x86 optimization not only come from the hardware, but majority of them come from the software optimization. Because we realized you could build your own x86 machine, right? It's from Intel, you could build your own. But the smartness comes from the in-memory optimization. And that's there in the cloud. Okay. Again, going back to the theme of, I don't know how much time I have. Okay. So, in terms of going to reaching the new users, so I talked about how we are making it easy to reach the new users, right? Forget about the new users, even the existing users. Mike and I having a conversation like a few months back. So we had this, let's say somebody runs a CAL script, and then retrieves those information in SmartView. They're looking at numbers. The numbers don't look right. They go back and look at CalScript. It looks perfect. What do they do? Right? You're basically stuck. You can then ask all the experts, go to forums, you desperately look at logs. You're basically stuck, right? Unlike a traditional programming language where you can fire up a debugger and get in and step by step, you don't know what to do, right? This is one of the design principles we had in mind, right? Like I said, we are late to the cloud because we were spending time doing all of this, right? So we realized for us to succeed in the cloud and reduce the number of escalation calls, we need to be more self-service. For both for experts and also for new user. Even experts would benefit from that, right? Even because there's no information in the log. Sometimes, you need to write a 4,000 line CAL script, you may be making some typo somewhere, right? No human is perfect, right? So we want to be able to tell you, so we were looking for, okay, what is the best way to do it? We went with what Excel is doing. If you go to Excel, click on a formula, and you say trace precedence or trace dependence, it actually points you to where the dependency is coming from. So we were motivated by that and then say, if you have a number, what if we expose some of the secret things or some of what the engine does to the users, right? So because when you write a CAL script, you may not know the same number may be computed multiple times, right? And the last one wins. So we want to show you all the times the usage was. So we introduced this notion called calculation tracing. So you need to enable it through an application config. So we know you are in that mode. When you are in that calculation tracing mode, when you run a CAL script, we trap every write to every cell, so it is a little slow, right? And then when you're writing it, we compare it to the POV that you are tracing. And if that cell is being modified, we grab all the, what is the formula being executed, what are the dependents, and then we actually print that information back in the smart view. Hey, this is the previous value, these are all the dependent values, and this is the final value. And this is the line in the CAL script that actually did that storage, okay? It's pretty cool and pretty awesome, okay? And now, if let's say cell C depends on A, B, D, and now C was wrong, now you know A, B, and D, what the value engine was using, now B looks suspicious. Now we go to B, and you trace B. So you are not stuck anymore, right? You can repeat that process so I have a practical example. I was writing a forecasting script where I was using the current year 2017. I also have a historical shift percentage script where I was using, supposed to use previous year. But I had a typo where I put 2017 there. So the script was able to actually help me figure out that particular issue. Otherwise, I would have spent, because as humans, we cannot obviously notice some of the typos, okay? On top of that, we realized some of the error messages that we print historically has not been very intuitive or very helpful. we have enhanced it significantly to print the more accurate information, better line numbers, and there are tons of improvements like that. And I talked about auto generation of cubes. We also have a similar to calculation tracing, when you are computing a dynamic member, by the way, let me plug in. Cameron and Tim have a deep dive session on Thursday. We are going to talk about a lot of these. We can do a demo. You can come to our booth where we can show you some of the tracing demos. So we also have the query tracing where you can actually point at any dynamic member and say, let's say you have seven dynamic dimension. Like many of you are familiar with solve order, right? That's how the information is computed in ASO. In hybrid BSO, we follow the same principle. Like in a multidimensional world, if you have any cell, there are many paths to get to that. So which path we walk, the engine walks, you want to know. And that is guided by the solve order. So you pick any cell, go to smart view, show the breakdown. It'll show you all the dynamic member that is constitutes this particular cell, the solve order for each one of those dynamic member, and say which one was one, and what is the formula that was used to compute that. So this is again helps you get unstuck. You are not in the blind anymore. Engine, we want to expose more and more of what engine does to you so that you can be more independent, okay? And another cool thing is, if you don't like that, let's say you don't want to do aggregation first and then calculation next, you can make the calculation first and aggregation next by simply changing the solve order, okay? There are a lot of examples like that we can show you. And we are just getting started. As you know, we are live in the cloud, and we want you guys to get access to it, get us feedback, and you can imagine what kind of improvements will come in the subsequent. So we would love to have more adapters so that we can improve our software, right? We strongly believe we can improve when users start using it, okay? We also have the notion of audit trail and metadata audit trail. So you can enable it or you don't want to enable it. There may be some amount of penalty in terms of time. We haven't actually measured it yet. Every write, lock and send to the system is now tracked. And you can go and say who changed what from what value to what other value, and then we show you a report of that, okay? This is pretty cool because this is more useful in the scenario management context, right? If I have a scenario where I have multiple participants, I can see who's changing what number. Similarly, we also have a metadata audit trail, right? You have many users in the system. You don't know who changed what. Somebody might have changed it accidentally. When you change the solve order, with changing a formula, making something shared. So we track all those metadata changes and exactly what time they changed, and you did a metadata dimension build, we tell you all of that. Another cool thing we did is, yeah. For now, this feature just got implemented. Right now, we are not truncating anything. We'll think about some truncating strategy. So the last one is, there are two other things. The job queue is made asynchronous, meaning if you have a long-running cal script, you don't have to sit and wait. You can just kick it off and then go log out and then come back and check in, okay? This is very, very fundamental. Like, this is one of the key design principles for us, because for us to define a scalable system, we determine that we need an architecture that runs non-blocking execution. I'll tell you why, because over a period of time, you may find, I want to limit the number of restructured jobs to one. And we don't have that today, but we have enough framework to say different job types, you can limit how much concurrency you want to support, okay? And the fact that it is asynchronous and we are able to put a limit on it gives you a nice scalable system, okay, which is very fundamental. And being a pass, all the logs are accessible. Like, that's another usable feature. The last thing is, I'll tell you an example. I have a DBX workbook that has a XRF to two other DBX workbook. So what I did was, one of the workbook I'm referring to was a currency rates queue. So I have a sales in local currency. I'm referring to that currency rate queue to get the currency, doing a conversion. So I uploaded the currency rate queue, DBX workbook. I uploaded my my workbook. Then I went to SmartView to try to query. It complained you didn't create a location alias. It was pretty annoying because both the cubes are in the same host. The system knows about the currency rate cube. Why should I paint the user, go to the web UI, create a location alias, and then you need to carry that around with your LCM and whatnot. So to improve that usability, we said, look, if we'll try to be smart about it. We expanded the XREF syntax to say, at XREF, you can say currency, comma, rates. It would try that as a, it will say, oh, is there a cube like that? If not, it will look for a location alias. If not, it will error out. So this is the kind of usability we think about it on a daily basis, right? We want to minimize the number of clicks so that it's more intuitive and more usable. We did the same for partition so that you have less thing to maintain. But it doesn't mean we don't support remote location aliases. For that, you still have to create a location alias, okay? Yeah. The stability and performance, like I want to touch upon this because, see, the way I broke down is we have different parts of my team was focused on different parts of this. So, like I said, people are buying our engine not for the cool tools, but for the core functionality that we provide. It's the amazing experience of analytics in Excel, right? And also, it's a scalable Essbase engine. But at the same time, it needs to be stable and performance. Like, just to touch upon that point, I think you might have seen this slide in few conferences. We are not new to the cloud, okay? The crux of the engine is running on the cloud for 5+ years. We are on the Fusion Cloud and also on the EPM Cloud for several years, and they have been doing pretty well, right? We are the source of truth for EPM Cloud, right? As you know, all the artifacts get persisted in, not in database, but in Essbase, right? And it's being pounded on by thousands of customers and thousands of users every day, right? So, and we are building up on top of that. So, this basically summarizes that, and also I touched upon a lot of the architectural changes we did. We didn't want the Essbase seg file. Anyone who's used for several years would know, like, the Essbase seg file used to get corrupted. The problem is, file system is not transactional in nature. Unlike database, which where you can roll back, it's very difficult to roll back in if the stars are aligned in such a way that you crash right at the moment that something is getting stored in a Essbase seg file, maybe even today the corruption can happen, right? It's not designed like a database level stability. This is one of the reasons we wanted to move all those artifacts to a table, and we moved to a modern J2E engine, okay? See, another thing you may notice is many of you are familiar with the Essbase file system structure. You probably know app and a DB folder. Inside that, you might have seen OTL and index and page file. You will see a new folder in cloud called cube. Okay? What was happening was when a restructure was going on, OTL file gets copied to a OTN file, and then it gets modified. When it is done, the OTN will get written into OTL file. Luckily, we never got corruption on this. There is a small window where this can get corrupted. So what we decided was we created a previous folder and a new folder where the previous the official schema would be under cube folder. We'll temporarily create a folder where we'll do the restructure, and then we will do an atomic swap at the end. And this has completely eliminated the chance of corruption at any point. So the window of that is very, 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 very small. And we even eliminated that there are two people worked on it for almost 18 months to do that. You can see the kind of thinking we are putting behind in terms of re-architecting our code base, okay? So this is, Tim Toy is here. They use API to build their software. So we are very committed to providing headless and API access to that. We are not committed to our UI. You can build your own UI and use our API to build, cool, best-looking UI that access Essbase, right? And we strongly encourage that, right? Or you can build your own UI that talks to many other systems and show Essbase in a common place. So one of our customers is doing that, okay? And we also we understand that many of you have invested a lot in your processes for backend automation, daily refresh, nightly refresh. We thought a lot about it, right? So all the automation you are doing today is completely possible with cloud, okay? And it uses secure and proper protocol. And integration, let me just quickly skip through it. You probably heard about DB and Essbase. It's a direct integration. It's pretty strong. We also have an integration to the cloud console, which is where you subscribe to service, where you can do a lot of the activities like backup and start and shut down and so on. So where are we going next? So you already heard about lots of things, but we are not done. Okay, we want to maintain the edge. We are going to come up with an administrative dashboard. We'll have some kind of a performance advisor. The key thing I want to talk about here is dimension properties. Okay, so we'll soon have a lot of support for arbitrary text string that you can associate with a member. Okay, and that you can see it in a smart view. When you do a zoom in, the dimension will zoom in. All the associated properties will go with it. So you can see arbitrary number of columns with any number of properties associated with it. Okay, this has been a pent-up demand for a long time, and that's coming. So take-home message. Needless to say, we consider ourselves a temporary. So I am probably the 10th guy who's managing Essbase. So it's been out there for a long time. We take a lot of pride in being a guardian of this beautiful software. And as I highlighted, we try to make it better and better every day. Okay. There's a huge expectation. What we love is the strong commitment to this software. Not many software have been around for 25 plus years, right? Because the technology has changed, but and particularly the same user interface, I don't think anyone else has been that long, right? Maybe a handful of them. And we want to maintain that. We are strongly committed to it. And there is no matter how fast we are, like I always tell my team, instant gratification isn't soon enough. People always want more faster queries, okay? So just to close out, my hope and prediction for your next quarter forecast is hopefully you'll all come to the cloud with, and then one more plug-in. Mike has a session at 4:45 where we'll talk about all the new features in the cloud, okay? So unfortunately it's under my name, so look for Essbase new features, okay? Thank you.